Today on the menu, we have something very interesting. A genetically engineered offspring of pistons and rotaries that allegedly inherits only the best genes from its parents. A completely novel creation that runs and has already proven itself on the test bench. An engine that has already taken flight. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to introduce you to the Roto Piston Engine.
Nope.
Huh?
It's called a birotary.
It's called a what?
A birotary.
A birotary? Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm sure.
But I mean, come on, look, there's a piston and the piston rotates, roto piston.
No, it's called a birotary.
Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to introduce you to the birotary engine, yet another novel engine design with an utterly confusing name. But names aside, this thing is very cool. And today we are going to explain how it works. We are going to explore its benefits and drawbacks. We are going to compare it to a direct competitor, traditional piston engine. And then we are going to see whether this thing has the potential to go beyond its current target market, which is small aircraft. We are going to see whether it has what it takes to penetrate into the coveted motorcycle and automotive markets. Let's get started. The birotary engine consists of three pistons attached to a central crankshaft. The pistons complete their strokes inside a round cylinder block. This round cylinder block rotates inside a fixed housing. And here we have our first benefit. The cylinder block rotates in the opposite direction to the crankshaft, which means that they partially cancel out each other's reaction torques and gyroscopic effects. Oh, now I get it. So the crankshaft rotates and the block rotates. So that's one, two rotations by rotary. I still think roto piston is a better name. This engine is actually very similar to having two counter-rotating crankshafts, but without the added mass and bulk. Anything that rotates at a certain speed has a momentum. This momentum creates torque. And this torque is trying to spin or twist the vehicle the engine is attached. This is especially noticeable in small and light aircraft whose reduced mass often suffers from unbalanced engine forces which are trying to twist and or roll the airframe and therefore require various means of compensation for this effect. But if we have two sources, each generating a momentum in the opposite direction, then the forces cancel out. The other consequence of a body spinning at high speed is a gyroscopic effect which tries to resist the vehicle's change of direction. You have probably felt this effect yourself a bit if you ever played with a fidget spinner. But if we have another body spinning at high speed, but in the opposite direction, we can reduce or even completely eliminate the gyroscopic effects, and this then improves vehicle maneuverability. The result is that our birotary engine is superior in this regard compared to a traditional piston engine, which has nothing rotating in the opposite direction to the single crankshaft, leaving the gyroscopic and reaction torque effects of the spinning crankshaft unbalanced. Something else that a rotating cylinder block does is that it makes it possible to completely get rid of valves and cams and all of their associated components. If you have a rotating block, all you need are holes in the housing to do intake, compression, combustion, and exhaust. Here we have our intake and our exhaust ports. As you can see, they're just holes in the housing. And here we have our spark plug. As the cylinder travels, the bore of the cylinder eventually lines up with the intake port. Air and fuel enters the cylinder. The cylinder continues moving, the piston goes up and compresses the air-fuel mixture. After this, the cylinder filled with the compressed air-fuel mixture comes under the spark plug, which ignites the air-fuel mixture, producing combustion pressure, which drives the piston down, which then acts on the crankshaft and produces torque. Finally, the cylinder coincides with the exhaust port and exhaust gas leaves the engine. The birotary engine fires every 180 degrees of crankshaft rotation. This means that it fires as often as an inline four or boxer four conventional engine, which is an impressive feat considering that it has one cylinder less. However, comparing the firing intervals like this with conventional engines paints a bit of an incomplete picture. Remember, in the birotary, both the crankshaft and the cylinder block rotate. What's very important to know is that the crankshaft rotates 3 times faster than the cylinder block. So when the crankshaft does 180 degrees in one direction, the block is going to do 60 degrees, that's one-third of the speed, in the other direction. And that means that the engine fires every 240 degrees of total relative engine rotation. And yes, 240 degrees, that's the exact same firing interval as a conventional inline three-cylinder engine. The question is, do we count the block rotation or not? What's fair? Honestly, I don't know. So I'm going to leave that one up to you in case you haven't fallen asleep or clicked away from this mind-numbing video. In case you're still watching, I'm sure you're wondering, why does the crank need to rotate 3 times faster than the block? Well, that's because this is an aerial engine, which means that it's designed to spin a propeller. And propellers, they need to rotate slower than a combustion engine in order to remain efficient. Yes, propeller. That's how I pronounce it. What are you going to do about it? You know what's the name of the company that makes this engine? It's called Knob Gear. Yes, Knob. It's a Czech surname. No, it's not Knob. It's Knob. Knob. Knub, 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 ASMR, ASMR, ASMR. The birotary engine incorporates a planetary gear set with a reduction ratio of 3-to-1 between the crankshaft and the rotating cylinder block. The cylinder block is what the propeller is connected to, and this is why it must rotate slower than the crankshaft. This is actually another benefit for the birotary, because a planetary gear set is simple and robust, and it adds less length compared to a traditional reduction gearbox that can be found between the propeller and the engine of many conventional anatomies. Something else that's interesting about this engine is that it revs very high, 10,000 RPM. However, that's not 10,000 RPM the way we're used to. You see, in this engine, 2 key engine elements are rotating, so deciding how to count the RPM can be a bit problematic. Knob Gear does it like this. When the engine block and the propeller are doing 2,500 RPM, the 3-to-1 reduction means that the crankshaft is spinning 3 times faster, which is 7,500 RPM. The engine RPM is the sum of these two, the total RPM, which is 10,000 RPM. So to compare the birotary with a conventional engine, we need to do some basic math to get crankshaft RPM, which is 7,500, which is still higher than any conventional four-stroke competitor aerial engine. So we have to ask ourselves, why does the birotary rev higher? Well, the answer is because it can and because it must. Yes, I know that doesn't make any sense, but please bear with me. If you observe this engine more closely, you will notice that the crankshaft incorporates an absolutely minimal distance between the center and the crank pin. The result is a super short stroke engine. And as we know, less stroke means less leverage, and less leverage means less torque. But a short stroke also means that the piston has to cover less distance, which means reduced piston speed. And that means reduced forces and vibrations, which means that the engine can rev very high. But because each individual combustion has minimal leverage at its disposal, it means that each combustion event creates a small torque pulse. This is why we need to stack up thousands of torque pulses over a short period of time to create an adequate power output. Since each individual punch is weak, we must deliver a lot of punches over a period of time in order to create some damage. This is why we must rev high. Okay, but this then begs the question, can the engine be designed differently? Can we make a long stroke birotary anatomy? The answer is no. And that's because the birotary shares a key limitation with all the other rotary anatomies out there, and that's the distance between the ports. Here we can see the distance between the spark plug and the beginning of the exhaust port. As you can see, that's approximately 60 degrees. In terms of time, this is very, very little. It tells us that the piston has an absolutely minuscule time window to complete its stroke. If the stroke of the piston were longer, if the piston had to cover a greater distance during this minuscule time window, it would have to travel so fast that it would create forces capable of tearing the engine apart. The only way to create a long stroke by rotary engine would be to eliminate one spark plug, one intake, and one exhaust port. This would of course make the engine fire less often, and that would reduce the power output. A conventional piston engine does not have this design constraint, as there is no direct correlation between the firing interval and the stroke of the engine. You probably already noticed these little orange things, right? Yes, they're the seals. I'm pretty sure some of the more zealous keyboard warriors have already commented something like, "It's still a rotary, so it still has apex seals, so it sucks." And they probably did so long before getting to this point in the video. Yes, it's still a rotary. No, it doesn't have apex seals. You know why? Because there's no apex. A rotor isn't triangular like in a Wankel, so there's no apex. In fact, the bi-rotary is the best sealing rotary of all the rotaries. It's superior in this regard to both the Wankel and the liquid piston engine, and that's because here our rotor is a perfect circle. And that means that our seals are in the housing and are completely static. In the Wankel, the seals are in the rotor, which means that they are subject to some very complex loads and forces. The liquid piston engine improves upon this because it too has static seals. However, they are also subject to more complex loads because the rotor isn't a perfect circle. In the bi-rotary, the seals are in simple constant contact with a perfect circle. This means that they have the easiest job of all. But the perfectly circular rotor enables one more sealing advantage, and that's an increased number of seals. Both the Wankel and the liquid piston can only afford one seal per chamber, but not the bi-rotary. It can stack seals, and as you can see, we have three seals on each side of the combustion chamber and one seal preventing exhaust gases from entering into the intake. We also have double face seals. All of this means that a bi-rotary engine should have much less blow-by and noticeably improved emissions compared to both a Wankel and a liquid piston engine. Now, let us sum up the benefits and drawbacks. We have a very compact engine, it's well-balanced, it fires more often than a conventional engine with the same number of pistons, we have the best sealing of all the rotaries, and we do all of this without needing valves or cams. Our only real drawback seems to be that we are limited to short stroke designs. I don't know about you, but to me, this seems like it genuinely manages to combine the best of both worlds. The perfect child of a rotary mudder and a piston fodder. Or is it a rotary fodder and a piston mudder? Who cares? What's more important now is to see whether theory translates into practice. Now let's now compare this engine to a direct competitor. The Rotax 912S, probably one of the most popular small aircraft engines in the past two decades. So these two engines, they have the exact same power output, but they have different displacements and different dimensions. As you can see, the bi-rotary manages to put out the same power with just over half the displacement and a noticeably smaller size. So no matter how you look at it, the bi-rotary is more power dense, which is most certainly an impressive feat. Okay, but what about the weight? Well, weirdly enough, the bi-rotary is heavier, although I'm not sure on this one. Rotax clearly explains on their website what's included and what's not included in their dry weight, whereas bi-rotary just says dry weight. We don't know what's included. To me, it seems a bit weird that the bi-rotary is heavier. I did message them on their website a week ago asking some questions, but I never received a response, so unfortunately I can't give you any more details on the weight. Okay, so the bi-rotary wins in the power density department. What about noise, vibrations, fuel economy, and time between overhauls? Well, the bi-rotary likely has less vibrations, but it probably creates more noise, and that's because it revs much higher. When it comes to fuel economy, it's anyone's guess. I'd say that the bi-rotary fuel economy is likely similar or slightly worse than that of the Rotax. We have just over half the displacement, but almost twice the RPM. We have an increased number of seals and thus potentially higher friction in the birotary, but the Rotax also has the friction associated with the valve trains of two cylinder heads. I'll leave this one undecided. Time between overhauls is probably higher in the Rotax since it doesn't rev as high. Although the birotary is short stroke and a low piston speed, 10k RPM is still 10k RPM. Overall, the increased power density, the lack of cams and valves, and the very high red line remind me of a two-stroke. But the birotary also offers fuel economy, emissions, and time between overhauls comparable to that of a four-stroke. If this is true, this engine offers a very interesting combination of benefits that should make it an extremely attractive choice in its target market, which in my opinion means that it has a good chance of success. So that's a story for the small aircraft market. Looks promising. What about cars and motorcycles? Unfortunately, in its current anatomy, as the engine is now, it has an absolutely minimal chance of penetrating the motorcycle market and zero chances of penetrating the car market. And that's because it has pathetic low RPM performance and a questionable transient response. That's not an issue with small aircraft because once you get up to desired RPM, you're going to spend most of your flight at or very near that RPM. Whereas cars and bikes, they use pretty much the entire RPM range all the time, which is why transient response and low RPM performance is so important. The problem with the birotary is that we have a very short stroke and a lack of variable valve timing and lift to help us. The intake and exhaust ports in a birotary are 100% fixed. You can't do anything about it once you construct the engine. The very short stroke means that we have not just small leverage, but it also means very low piston speed at low RPM, and that means very low intake air velocity, which means poor air and fuel mixing, which means weak combustion, which means pathetic low RPM performance. This combined with the fixed ports means that we can really only optimize this engine over a pretty narrow RPM range. Again, kind of like a two-stroke. This is not an issue for small aircraft, but it is pretty problematic for cars and motorcycles. All in all, I have to say that I really like this engine. It is somehow reasonable and logical, and it's beautifully adapted and focused on its target market. And I honestly hope that we get to see more of it in the future. As always, thanks a lot for watching, and I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel. Actually, there's one more thing. I know I'm super late to the party, but I made a little calendar for 2026, where like January is a single cylinder, February is a twin, March is a triple, April is an inline four, and so on and so forth until December. Question is, what did I put in there for July, September, and November? Well, if you want to find out, you're going to have to buy the calendar. Yes, I'm using cheap tricks to make up for my lack of graphic design skill and creativity. Actually, here's a challenge for you. Buy the calendar, and then when it arrives, don't flip through the pages. Instead, wait for November 2026 to find out about the 7, 9, and 11 cylinder engines. Be a true stoic in an age of instant gratification. Of course, I'm kidding. The calendar is totally optional. I'd save my money for something else. I want to say I wish you all the best in 2026. Once again, thanks a lot for watching, and I'll be seeing you next year.